Hello, everybody. I mean, welcome all. A very good evening, and thanks for joining us again for our Friday Funda. I think this is the first time where we are having a kind of a non-design and non-artistic kind of a topic, but this is like very, very crucial for as a whole. I mean, if you are into entrepreneurship and if you want to build a company and see the complete journey from scratch, and also not just being an entrepreneur, but also building a company successfully and also able to sell it off, right? And I'm now sitting relaxed at home, and he also started thinking that what to do next. So I think it's a great journey. So we have Harpreet with us, who was CEO and co-founder of CoCubes, so where he started almost more than a decade back, in somewhere around 2007, and also he was successfully able to sell the company to the much big deal with AO and Hewitt, right? So he's going to quickly walk us through the journey, what he has gone through. Definitely, it's going to be a fun, right? In terms of, it's going to be would have gone through a lot of roller coasters via this company journey. So a little bit of a background, so Harpreet, I mean, he comes with a engineering background. So he had a dual degree with IIT. And he just worked for a couple of years. I guess it was just, I mean, I think he already decided that he wanted to start a company. I don't know why he spent the 2 years. Maybe he might just help us to understand. So all the way, he spent enough time only on trying to build an awesome company, right? And apart from the startup and stuff, I think he's very passionate about, in general, education and towards, career and stuff. And also he's a physical, I mean, a kind of a fitness freak. So heavily into mountaineering and hill running.
I broke my hand.
Yep.
That's why I'm not all full ready to see you guys. Yeah.
Yep. So I'll just give a 2 minute anecdote, and then I'll set the stage for Harpreet, right? So how do I know Harpreet? I mean, way back in maybe in 2002 or 3. Generally, Mood Indigo is one of the India's best cult fest, right? Nothing can beat it. But then something strange happened in 2002-2003 where TechFest, which is still always has to be one step below the Mood Indigo, these guys broke all the records and
I became in charge of publicity.
Bar, right? So I think Harpreet was one of the key member. He was one of the GSEC and who was into marketing and more into sales part of it. So that's where we kind of touch base, and so I just by mistake offered my help, and it was a nightmare to kind of work with him because he is an absolute go-getter. So he will not hesitate to knock your door at 3 a.m. right, because he wants his job to be done, right? So that's the kind of a perseverance. And
Ryan was a typical designer. He will commit and then not get the design done on time. Dude, I couldn't have an idea, man. The idea didn't strike my head. But you told me you will do it by now.
Yeah, absolutely. But the whole part is ultimately he's a sweet talker, and he'll make the best out of you. He'll try to make sure he get the best out of whoever he's trying to work. And I think the entrepreneurs was already seen in him way back in 2002.
So I don't think sweet talker is a compliment. I'm telling you, it sounds like a fucking comment, man.
Okay, so I let Harpreet, kind of walk us through his journey. And please, guys, feel free to ask as many questions as possible so we can make it more interactive rather than make really a monologue from Harpreet. Over to you, Harpreet.
Okay, thank you, man. So thank you for all the comments. Yeah. I couldn't sense any compliments there, though. Then you try to below the belt comments, man. Okay. So anyways, guys, good to see all of you. I'll take 10, 15 minutes and keep chatting with you. You have the chat window. You have the Q&A window. Feel free to write and ask whatever you want to. The goal is to share some part of the journey. We could, maybe I'll try to see if you want to use a deck. But essentially, we started the company in 2007. Vibhor and I were co-founders. We were roommates at IIT Bombay. That's where I met Dayan. Then I graduated in 2007. I started CookCubes with Vibhor. What happened was that my mom called me when I was in office. And my mom said, Harpreet, this uncle wants to meet you. I used to work in Gurgaon in a company called Inductus. I said, but, you know, I don't want to meet him. But you know how moms are in India. And she persuaded me to meet him. He came across and she said that, I want to meet your HR. And I asked him, why do you want to meet him? He said, I want to get him to come to my college for recruitment. And I said, okay, I got him a meeting. He spent some time and he went away. I caught him at a function, you know, 3 months down the line, 3 months passed. I was going to a family function. I caught him there and I said, you know, hey, uncle, what happened? I got you a meeting. And he said, beta, you know, we go to Delhi, Bombay, Chennai. We ask everybody to come. Everybody says they'll come, come. Nobody comes. So I went to my HR. This was 2007. And he said, Harpreet, there's so many colleges out there. You know, everybody comes and talks to me. Your uncle's college is 500 kilometers away. If I go and I'm unable to hire, I'll get fired from my job. You know, so I don't know how to make that call. So I went to Google and I searched. And it seems like in India, there were 34,000 colleges back then. I'm not sure if that has increased or decreased now, but there are definitely 30,000 plus colleges even now. And making a choice which college to go to is still very, very difficult. So, you know, but when I saw that, I called up Vibhor and I said, yaar, ye problem achhi lag rahi hai, college kaise jayenge, let's start a company on this. The trivia for you here is, I also called this guy on the other side called Dhayan and said, why don't you start with us? And this guy refused. But you know, that's good trivia. If you know him well, you can tease, pull his leg about him in the company. But we started in 2007. You know, the call had come in 2006. It took us a year to figure things out. 2007, we started. We raised an angel round. We raised two rounds of venture capital. You know, till we were, the name CoCubes came from the first two letters of three words, connecting colleges and companies. So CO cross CO cross CO, CO Cubes was the name of the company, right? And we raised an angel round from our manager who at Inductus, Vibhor used to work at Microsoft Research. Then, you know, we raised two rounds of VC capital. Then we realized there was no product market fit. We had to fire 70% of our team. This was in 2011-12. We were looking to raise a big round. We were raising $5 million from, you know, a global fund, but that didn't come through. And that was a very, very hard time for us. It was that time, you know, we had about 150 people in the company and we had to let go about 100 people. You know, we had told their parents 6 months earlier, we had sent a letter to everybody saying, you know, we're happy, you know, your son and daughter are working with the company. We look forward to a bright future. And now we were actually asking people to go. So extremely hard time. But, you know, after that, we shifted from becoming a venture-backed company to becoming a company who we said we wanted to be profitable on the company. We wanted to repay because, you know, if investor money goes, that's okay. But loans are supposed to be repaid back. So we again started rebuilding the company. And this time we rebuilt the company as a profitable company. We had actually no other choice. But fortunately, we were able to do that. You know, today CoCubes revenue is about $8 million. You know, high margins. We sold the company 3 years ago to Aon Hewitt. There was a good offer on the table. We sold it for about 100 crores or so and made some money. And I moved to Bombay. You know, this is in short the story of CoCubes. I have, you know, some learnings and lessons from it that I'm trying to project. Let's see if you can see them. And let's see. Yeah. Okay. Can you guys see the deck? Just send me a hello on yes. chat if you can see it. Okay. Then, okay.
Yeah, it's just loading up.
Okay. Okay. Not yet. Okay. Now I think then you can see, right? Because Ramu tells me he can see it. Can you see it?
Not yet.
No?
We can all see it's a black screen.
Okay. Can you see
maybe,
it now?
Maybe you might have to share your entire desktop.
I did. Let me try sharing something else. Let me share this. Does this work? No?
No, not it.
No? Okay, no problem. I'm saying that's okay.
It's okay. Do you want me to download the deck? I have it. Oh, yeah. I think we got it. Yes, yes, we got it.
Okay, you can see it now?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. Oh, excellent. Thanks, Vikram. Thanks, Amu. Thanks, Mohammed. Cool. So, guys, this was the crux of our story. But there were some learnings and lessons that I wanted to share with you. You know, the first one
you want to make it full screen? I mean, control L.
See, Dhan, you're a lifesaver, man.
Always.
Always. Okay. So, you know, the learning one was on taking an idea. You know, when we started CoCubes, we actually didn't think how big this idea could become. It was just a problem we came across and we wanted to solve it. And that was about it. Actually, we picked a very bad field. You know, we picked something in education, something in HR, something which was B2B selling because you had to go to companies and colleges to sell. It was just a very bad business to be in India at that time. You know, B2B startups have become hot now. But at that point in time, selling to B2B companies in India was very difficult. It still is actually difficult, you know. And education was tough and colleges were tough and HRs were difficult to deal with. But we picked something that was our passion. We didn't pick something which was hot. At the same time, so this is something that a call that you will need to make. At the same time, you know, picking something which we were passionate about helped us do it for 10 years. You know, our outcome was not very big. You know, it was only 100 crores. But essentially, when we started, we wanted to build a $1 billion company. But we were able to pursue it till that point because, you know, it was our passion. So when you pick an idea, you know, you have to choose, you know, what do you want to pick, what is hot or what is passion. It is great if your passion is something which is hot right now. You know, then you have a great advantage. But if you continue pursuing your passion, there will be some time when it will become hot. Actually, the time for CoCubes is now when COVID is there. You know, so if we hadn't sold 3 years ago, now would be a great time to have a company like CoCubes. But this is the lesson that I learned on picking an idea. Actually, I'm an angel investor. In 2014, I invested in a lot of companies because startups had really become hot. And every company that I invested in, which the founder had started because entrepreneurship had become cool, you know, actually shut down. The only people still in play are people who really wanted to build a company, you know, and who were passionate about the idea that they wanted to do. So let me just move ahead. Our second learning was on raising money. A lot of people, you know, all of us read about, oh, this company raised $100 million. This company raised $50 million. Oh, you know, they came in the newspaper. You know, the newspaper goes to the dustbin that day, but it leaves an impact on our mind that somehow raising so much capital is what I have to do with my company. This is the only way to build a startup. You know, that is not true. FN Studios is one example of it. But the real question that you need to answer to yourself is that, is your company VC fundable? What this means is the idea that you have started, is that a $1 billion idea? Because that is what the VC is looking for. You know, VC wants, a venture capitalist wants to invest in a company if they believe that one company can return their entire money that they are putting everywhere. So if there's a venture capital who is $100 million and they give you $2 million, the expectation is, can this company give me $100 million back? To give them $100 million back, you will need to sell for $500 million. That means you need to become a $1 billion company. So the idea you are, and you know, a lot of entrepreneurs keep going and talking to VCs saying, oh, mana kar rahe hai, and thinking maybe my idea is bad. A lot of times the idea is not bad, you know, just that it is not VC fundable. And that is something that, you know, everybody should keep in mind. And then obviously the tough part about building a company is not starting it. You know, it is actually building it over time. That takes time, energy. And there are some common mistakes that you make. One mistake is, you know, spending money on a cool office. Somehow one feels I need to have a good office to hire people. Does having a cool office help you hire people? Yes, it does. But most often it helps you hire the wrong people. Because, you know, these are people who come to a cool office and say, you know, they get the impression that everything is done, everything is sorted. But generally in a startup, you know, things are not sorted. Things are in works, things are broken, they need to be fixed. And so you attract people who want to be safe, who feel comfort, who want things sorted. But actually a startup doesn't work like this. So, you know, having a cool office is not a prerequisite. If you are raising money, if you're starting an office, I would strongly tell you not to spend on, you know, having a cool office at all. The second lesson we learned was on product market fit, which was that we actually expanded our sales before we found product market fit. we built a big sales team. We thought we had arrived, and we ended up having to fire the sales team and, you know, go down because we didn't have product market fit. We didn't have product market fit. But, you know, how did we find it out? Because we, our renewal rates were less. And, you know, as founders, we should have paid a lot more attention to renewal rates of customers. This is the only real metric for a B2B business. Are your customers renewing or not? And we did not have it. So, and we built our sales team, and, you know, that didn't go well for us. So if you're building a company, see renewal rates of customers. And once you have found product market fit is when you really need to push the pedal. You know, so for example, I had written actually a couple of other lines. From a designer perspective, a couple of things I learned was there were two phases of CoCubes. One was when we had VC capital, and then when we became a profitable company. In the first phase, we actually built what the user wanted. Whatever they wanted, we wanted to build because the user was asking for so many things. It was only in the second phase we realized we only had to build what the user needed. And the wants are just endless. We will never be able to get there. Just spoil the product. We actually redid the product. You know, we moved to saying we'll now build what user needs, not what user wants. And it is okay to say to wants of a user. An example that I remember is, you know, users would typically come and tell us. And, you know, if you're a designer and end up working with a sales guy, I think you'll appreciate this example. And they said, sales guy would come and say, you know, client bol raha hai ke humko assessments, we need one question on each page. And our module was such that if an assessment had 60 questions, we'll show all questions on one page. And, you know, they will push back saying, I'm unable to sell because the client wants everything on a single page. And we would say, yaar, you know, kyun chahiye, nahi chahiye. And then, you know, finally we said, let's go and talk to the customer. And then we asked the customer, yaar, why are you saying that I need one question only on one page? And he said, yaar, I need one question on one page because I think if all the questions are on one page, then students will do cheating. And then we told the customer, but, you know, these 60 questions are being picked from 10,000 questions. So actually students sitting next to each other don't have the same question paper at all. And he said, okay, if that is the case, then I don't need this. So, you know, the thing about users is that user tries to suggest solutions to you. But actually you need to go and ask him what is the problem that he wants to solve for. And that was a very big learning for me personally. The final thing on building a company is that, you know, whatever you do, you know, our goal was to build a company which was worth staying for. Build a company that we would like to enjoy working in, because that at least gave us a lot of happiness. There's something we actually spent a lot of time, energy. We had a culture certificate. People who completed the probation period, we used to give them a small silver coin in which it was written, you know, I am responsible for students' career. There was a CoCubes logo on it. We would do a ceremony to do it. And we had our culture guidelines and values set. You know, because what happens because of that is everybody knows, then you have these set guidelines that everybody believes in. Then I can trust my colleague's behavior. That means I can take a risk on my colleague's behavior. That means I can be open and I can say whatever I want to. And you can build a transparent culture. And a culture worth staying for is very important to build, more so in hard times. In every company, hard times will come. You know, only in hard times do people stay with a company which is not giving them money. Only. They stay with a company that they really love and they want to work for. So that was a big learning for us. You know, learning four was on selling a company. When we were not doing well, we tried selling the company. When we tried to sell the company, nobody bought it. And we realized that you cannot sell a company. Companies can only be bought. So you can only sell a company if somebody wants to buy a company. If you go to somebody and say, hey, you know, I want to sell my company, you want to buy it? Nobody really cares. They will give you dimes. Nobody would give you money. So somebody, you need to do such a great job at what you're doing that somebody needs to come to you and say, I want to buy your company. And that is when we were actually able to make a sale. And when you're in that position, then also having a plan B is of great value. What does this mean? This means that at all points in time, you should be, as an entrepreneur, be in a position to be able to say no to the deal. If you are in that position, then you can get the best outcome from that negotiation. Otherwise, you'll always be worried about whether this deal will happen or not. So, you know, these were some learnings. Then there were some lessons that I learned as an entrepreneur. You know, if you ever want to be an entrepreneur, even if you don't want to be, you know, maybe hopefully it will be useful to you in personal life. One is, don't underestimate hiring. You start a company thinking, hiring to ho hi jayegi, but it takes most of your time. You go and ask a founder, he has such big dreams. He just doesn't have good people who can align with his vision and, you know, fulfill those dreams. So don't underestimate hiring. Second is have a coach. You know, I had a coach in times when Cookies was not doing well, and I was confused. कि मैं क्या करूं, कस्टमर से बात करूं, क्लाइंट से बात करूं, लोगों को फायर किया, उनके मां-बाप से बात करूं, व्हाट शुड आई डू? एंड आई कॉल्ड हिम एंड ही सेड, हरप्रीत, यू नो, डोंट वरी अबाउट सो मेनी थिंग्स. यू एंड विभोर हैव बिल्ट अ कंपनी फॉर द लास्ट 5 years. आई एम श्योर यू हैव बिल्ट समथिंग वैल्यूएबल. सो फोकस ऑन व्हाट एसेट यू हैव क्रिएटेड एंड प्रोटेक्टेड फॉर द नेक्स्ट 6 months. एंड यू नो दैट सिंगल पॉइंट फोकस हेल्प्ड अस गो इन द डायरेक्शन ऑफ सेइंग व्हाट एसेट डू वी हैव and how can we monetize it to stay afloat. And that actually saved CoQs. To have somebody that you can trust, you know, and that you can reach out to and who can give you advice and whose advice is valuable to you, who has been in such positions before. The final thing is your personal life. For the first 5 years when I did a startup, I remember the day after 5 years when I came home and woke up the next morning and I had not opened my laptop. And I realized for 5 years, I had, you know, every day come home, work till late at night without actually paying attention to my wife, to my family and all of it. And it actually took, my wife actually took a job in Hong Kong and it took a job. And then, you know, she's been there for 6 months. And that is when I realized that I missed her. And it took that big moment for me to realize that for the last 5 years, I'm living with my wife, but I'm actually doing my company. So, you know, whatever you're doing in life, your work, your company, work, whatever it might be, you know, keep your personal life in check. You know, if you're living with somebody, you know, take an hour every day where you keep aside your phone, keep aside your work, talk to them, you know, take out the Sundays. Do all of this and maintain the balance in personal life for people who are spending time with you. You know, these were some lessons we learned here. So, you know, these are some of the learning and lessons that we had from our journey. So, you know, this is all I have for you guys. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to take them, happy to chat.
Yeah, guys, please, we are open for questions. You guys can punch in your questions in the Q&A or chat. But I do have a few, so I'll just get started with that. So first question, I mean, Arpit, I mean, first of all, thanks a lot. I think it was a very candid journey. And then some of the takeaways are pretty huge. I think it's pretty useful for us. So the first one which I had was, so a lot of people have this, now there's no question of ideas, right? There is, abundance of ideas. So how do people start? So what is that, the big pullback that why is that people are scared of starting something like that on their own? So any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think it's a big decision. So, you know, you need to be a little foolish to start a company, right? You need to really believe in something. And sometimes that belief is not so apparent. Or you know, you have financial commitments. And others say, I want to start a company if I get money. That won't work. Nobody will give you money. Because what they see is you are not. So my suggestion there is, don't think of starting a company as a first step. Think of starting a project. Work on it for 3-4 months. Find a co-founder. You know, build something every day. And if you really like it and love it, if it's going forward, you're finding users excited about it, then leave your job and do it. But don't hesitate to take the thing. My first step is I will leave my job. That is not the first step. It took us 1 year for us also to even leave our jobs.
Right.
Yeah.
I guess there's a little bit of lag.
I was saying that Priyanka has asked one question, what's the story behind Be Prepared? Be Prepared was a magazine. I'm surprised you know about it. How do you know about it? I would love to know if you can tell me. Maybe it's on my LinkedIn. But you know,
it's on LinkedIn.
When I was in my college, stalked you on LinkedIn. Yeah, one girl was stalking me before I got married. You know, essentially this when I was in college, I got invited for Inductus. They took us out for dinner. I mean, a 5-star after selecting, And somehow I had managed to get the highest score they had ever seen in interviews. So, you know, they asked me that, you knew all the questions, you know, that's why you were able to answer. And I didn't know the question, you know, I actually didn't know what question you. And they said, you're very stupid because we asked the same questions that we asked last year. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I said, that is actually quite stupid. So it actually got to me. And, you know, the rest of my final year, I used to collate experiences of everybody who was going through interviews and putting them together in a single place. And that became a magazine called Be Prepared. That became a website called Be Prepared, which I discontinued once I started CoCubes. But yeah.
Yep. So I think Santosh has a question on a coach, right? So how do you even manage to find the coach, right? So yeah. So let's say somebody doesn't have a coach.
Yeah.
So is a coach more of a advisor or a board member, or it should be like more of your, I don't know, like how do you, is there any tips?
So I think there are two parts, right? One is the company needs an advisor. Maybe your company needs an advisor. That's a separate thing. But I'm saying as an entrepreneur, you need a coach.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and a coach is, you know, for a long time, I used to think I don't need a coach, man. Why the fuck do I need a coach? I'm super smart, whatever. I don't need a coach. You know, mm-hmm. But it took all these incidents to happen for me to realize having someone external who you can trust and who is smart enough to talk to you and help you figure out the solution is very helpful. You know, a good coach doesn't give you the answer. He helps you discover the solution yourself, but they guide you in the right direction. Now, finding a good coach is difficult. It is not easy, right? So you need, and it is not possible that you have one person and that becomes your coach. You know, might have to change. There are different coaches for different times in life. You know, but I'm saying go and put some effort in trying to find the coach. You know, for example, first take the marriage analogy. We spend so many hours on our job, but we spend so little time generally in finding our life partner. Shaadi karne ke liye hum kam time lagate hain. You know, the people who are 28, 29, 30, whatever, let's say they want to get married, but they're still working for 12 hours, but they really want to get married, but they're spending 1 hour or half an hour a day on finding a life partner. To me, it doesn't make any sense. You know, because you're going to be spending 20, 30, 40 years of your life and you want to get married. So invest time in finding a life partner, you know, take it as a sales project, as an actual design project, whatever it might be. But that is very important. You know, if you marry the wrong person, you might have a great job, but your life will be hell. Similarly, you know, invest time in finding a coach, make mistakes. In coach, you don't have to marry him, but you can still make mistakes.
Okay. Yep. Absolutely makes sense. So in a continuation of my first question, right? So once you already have figured out you want to get started, but there is a big problem with trying to vet your ideas. So how do you validate your ideas? I mean, is it like good to, because when you talk to your friends and well-wishers, is that the right way to like vet your ideas, or maybe go to market? What's your learning on that?
Correct. I'm saying, you know, you should talk to your friends, you talk to your family, you should talk to everybody you want to talk to, but you should finally talk to users and see what users are saying. You know, your friends might think it is a great idea, but if they are not going to buy your product, it doesn't really matter what they think. So you need to go to users. In our case, I took my father's Maruti 800 at that point in time and actually, you know, spent 3-5 days visiting all the colleges in Punjab, trying to tell them, this is what we're building. Will you buy? And everybody said they will buy. By the way, the real thing is that all of them didn't buy after I launched. But, you know, going and talking to the user, you know, was one thing that I would strongly suggest. Take input of everybody else, but go and talk to the user.
Yep. So then is that also like, so you have this question of, user wants versus user needs, right? So the reason is because, I mean, I'm not sure. So how did you guys do that initial requirement analysis and stuff for all? So did you guys have a design team? I guess without a design team, you guys managed able to build a huge product, right?
So we did finally have a designer in-house, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Vibhor, you know, initially I used to be Vibhor as a tech person, but I'm saying he's actually a product guy. So, you know, he took care of the UX and all of it.
Mm-hmm.
When you refused to join, as you know. So, but over time, we did have a designer, obviously, in-house. But I think, you know, having a neat, clean, simple product which users love, is easy to use, is just such a great part of building a company. Because otherwise, you know, you might have all the money. You can spend all that money, but if all you're getting is consumer complaints, then you're really fucked up. Your life is mess.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think we have a question on the poll, so in the chat. Like, so I think it's more towards having a cool office, right? So so don't you think sometimes is having an established good office kind of gives a feel that, you know, it's kind of a secured feel for a good talent pool? So why not? Why should the good talent be deprived of a cool office?
No, they should never be deprived of a cool office, but they should go join Deloitte. You know, and let me first say, not having a good office, does it leave out talented people who will not join you? 100% it does. There should be no doubt about it, right? It does. I'm just saying, if you are running a startup and you have raised 2 crores, don't spend 50 lakh rupees on a cool office. You know, spend it on your users, on your product, you know, and find people who will join you because they believe in your idea, not because they see a cool office. If they really believe in your idea, you know, you will realize, I'm saying any of you are on the call, the day you believe in an idea, you will start to realize cool office stops mattering. It doesn't really matter. You know, in CoQ's for longest time, 8 years, actually till 8 years, we used to have somebody in office who used to make tea and then give it to everybody. For 8 years, people said, we want to have a coffee machine, tea machine, cafe coffee day machine. 8 years, we resisted. After we got acquired, Aeon brought a coffee machine. Everybody was super happy for 15 days. And then they started saying, oh, wo chai bana dega kya, wo chai bana dega kya. You know, because who wants to drink? You know, you don't want productization. You want customization. You want to feel that you're doing something important. Right? You know, the cool office will fade away.
Yeah. So how do you manage this scale part, right? So, I don't know, like from 2, 5, 10, and suddenly it might be 50, right? Like, yeah. So how do you manage the scaling part?
You mean in terms of people, in terms of companies, in terms of clients?
Yes, I think it. I mean, as a whole, as a company itself. Yeah, I mean, as you want to increase your team members, obviously, because there's more work, there's more clients, right? So, how did the scale part happen?
So I think we learned along the way. It's not something we knew intuitively. It took a lot of learning. I remember initially we actually built a lot of processes. You know, we replaced trust by process. And then we realized that actually we made so many processes. Actually, we needed people to get those processes implemented, fill Excel files, fill forms, do all of it. And then we realized we actually didn't need them. You know, what we wanted was quicker iterations till you find product market fit. You know, till you find product market fit, your company needs to run on trust. Haan yaar, ye kar do. You know, let's do it this way. And everybody in the room listens to it and goes and starts doing it, you know, rather than us building a process for it. Once you have product market fit, then that is when you start to need processes. And that is then also you try to keep it to a minimum. But, you know, you need to have some processes to manage people, to do reviews, to run, you know, client management, all of that. But I think there's an important distinction that before finding product market fit, run your company on trust. After finding product market fit, run your company on process.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So did that have a huge impact on your culture? So how did also, because you also mentioned in terms of the company culture, which is one of the key thing even in your book, right? So, but as a company scales, sometimes this culture takes a little bit of a toll, right? So how do you guys hit a balance?
I think the key to realize is that a company will have culture no matter what. Now, as an entrepreneur, what you can do is define it. If you don't define it, the company will still have some culture. Because you haven't defined it doesn't mean the company doesn't have culture. It has some culture. So it's best to define it so that you can control it and be the company that you really want to be. You know, but every time you hire somebody, hiring dilutes culture.
Okay.
right? So if you are a 100 people company and hire 900 people, you will dilute your culture. So you need to put in processes to, you know, mitigate that. Onboarding processes, having a buddy processes, you know, put on your value system, do a quiz on that. A lot of things that you need to do. So I think you need to have this understanding that hiring dilutes culture, and I need to protect my culture. I need to have everybody, you know, have the same understanding so that they can take a risk on other person's behavior. Because what should not happen is that you're working in a company. You know, I'll tell you what working in a big company is like, and I'm sure some of you have done that. Obviously, then you have been there. You know, working in a big company can feel like strangers at a cocktail party. You know, because it's such a big company and you're just part of the, you know, and working in a small company or a company which has culture will feel like old friends talking. You know, that is the difference. So that is what you need to keep in mind.
Okay, absolutely. So any tips on this hiring thing? What I mean, so apart from the normal process and stuff, what people generally do. So what is that you are learning that you guys were able to crack it, like to get the right talent in CoCubes?
Okay, let me actually summarize my learning there. Mm-hmm. There is leadership hiring, there is mid-level hiring, there is bottom hiring, mm-hmm. right? If you're hiring somebody at the entry level, hire for attitude. They can pick up skills. If they have brains, enough brains, and you hire for attitude, they will pick up skills. How do you hire for attitude? You know, you hire for attitude by seeing that before joining their company, have they done something in life which is worth doing? You know, mm-hmm. if let's say somebody wants to join your company and he has been a black belt in karate, or he has played state level table tennis, that means that person, if he or she puts their mind to doing something, will be able to do it.
Right.
So I use that as a big filter. If you had not done anything in life that far, that was a big no for me. That means you don't have what it takes to develop patience, do it over time. Right. Mm-hmm. The second thing is middle level hiring. Middle level hiring is always confusing because after logo ko 5-7 saal ka experience hota hai, they know how to crack interviews. They know what to say. Right. Yep. So the only way to hire good mid-level managers is a great reference from their last company. Uh-huh. Okay. If you don't get a good reference, which you do yourself, not the reference a person is giving, you know,
okay.
Then you hire, otherwise you don't hire. Then finally, if you want to hire somebody in leadership, then you invite them over to your house. You spend time with them. You go over to their house. You invite their family. You meet their family. Work together for a month and then take a call. So, you know, these are tips I would say leadership, mid-level, entry-level is what I would think of.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's
it. See, you're there on TV.
Hi.
I know. Okay, can I go back? Can I do this? Maybe. Okay, yes.
Yep. So I think how do you guys manage that tough part, yeah, which is the most would have been like tough times, right? When things don't go the way you want it. So it's because that's something which people don't very often face, right? So since you have already gone through that journey, so we would love to understand like how do you guys come out of that swamp?
So I think that was the toughest time of my life. You know, actually, we didn't have money in the bank and our funding round was not happening. And we still had 150 people. And we said, okay, it will happen. We'll do something. And we raised 2 crore rupees as debt from people. We said, aapko 2 mahine mein wapas kar denge. You know, because we'll get funding.
Okay.
The funding didn't happen. We spent those 2 crore. We again didn't have any money. And, you know, so now we had to make a choice between what kind of company we wanted to build. And the only option left was to build a profitable company. You know, our dream was to build something else. We wanted to build an engagement company, engage a lot of people. Then you know all of that, right? But we ended up becoming an assessment company. Why? Because we delayed firing people. You know, because it is very difficult as an entrepreneur to go and tell somebody, and then 100 people. No, I was 25 or 26, maybe, whatever. Right? To tell 100 people, sorry, you know, I can't give you money. Please go home. When you have actually spent so much time in hiring, creating culture, you're doing parties and everything. These are all your friends now. You know, but I think delaying that by 2 months was a, one of the worst calls I've done, but still doing it after 2 months was one of the best calls I made. You know, because the point is you have to do it, because as a job, as an entrepreneur, as a CEO, is for the company to survive. It is not to make friends. The company can only survive. You know, some people say 50% salary kam kar dete. Then everybody is equally unhappy. That doesn't make sense. You need to let half the people and pay the rest of the people full salary. That is the way it works, right? If you're really sure you don't have the money. And the way is to do it with empathy. You know, do it in the, I'm saying we actually let go of people. Those people 6 months, 1 year down the line were recommending their spouses, cousins, friends to us. Because they knew we did what we had to do, and we did it in a manner which told us what it was. And you know, yeah, so you know, that was how I, you know, how the entire journey went.
Yep. Cool. So I think we are almost there. So just last couple of questions. So so what's the next step? On a very personal front. So I know that you are already invested. I mean, you're more of an angel. Apart from that, like, what are you currently doing, and what's your next step?
So yeah, you know, we left the company a year ago. I spent my time 6 months writing the book. Penguin gave us a contract to write the book. So the, you know, we wrote the book, Let's Build a Company. It'll be released sometime this year, hopefully. And then I spent 6 months, you know, doing advisory with Ola. The goal next year is to find something that I'm excited to build. I love EdTech. I love the career. I love the fact that there is no platform out there where you go for your work related stuff. LinkedIn is no longer that platform. You know, LinkedIn is just a connection platform. So, you know, it's a company that is really in my mind, something I want to build. At the same time, I enjoy spending time with my daughter. All of you saw her, you know, and I think this initial education and what kids learn initially is very important. And I want to spend time on that. I have to make a choice at some point and, you know, go ahead and do it.
Absolutely.
Vibhor has already started one bank. So if any of you, you know, want to join a startup and you're not in Dhayan's company, please check out onebank.ai. You know, if you have a good techie, this is a great opportunity to actually do something in fintech with one bank.
So awesome. So any closing notes, Harpreet?
Yeah, I would just advice. Closing notes, per se, you have, you know, let's answer the question that was asked, since depression is a hot topic right now. You know, to feel depressed. Yeah, I don't actually, you know, I don't know if a person who's in depression really understand they are in depression or not. Only when they come out of it, you know, do they realize they were in a hole. I'm a happy-go-lucky person by nature. So I would like to think I was not in depression, but I can tell you people around me might have thought so. I actually had to type a message. In those times, WhatsApp wasn't there. I sent an SMS to my parents saying, don't worry, I'm not going to commit suicide. I'm just not talking because I don't have the time. You know, like I had to type it out.
Did you really do that?
What?
I said, I mean, did you do that?
I really did that. Because my parents were worried. I was not talking. I was insanely working 22, 23 hours a day. I was doing everything that was required. You know, I was quieter. Because I was so insanely focused on saving the company, otherwise it wouldn't have been saved at all.
Yeah.
It becomes very difficult, you know, till 3 months ago, you were the hottest entrepreneur in India. You know, you were in top 30 business world. You were on the cover of a magazine, all of that. And then suddenly you are in this one room office where you don't have enough space for people to keep their elbows on the desk because the desk you made was so small because you had to fit more people. And you go into a shock yourself. So it's very hard. But you know, we managed to get through. What I would say is, yes, depression obviously is real. So if you know somebody who's going through it, you know, go and talk to the person. You know, telling that person, you know, try to come out of it doesn't really help because they're trying and they can't do it. You know, take them to a doctor who can cure it, give them medicines, talk to them often. So whatever you can, Yeah, and I think on the closing remarks then that you asked, I think all of us have one life to live. So, you know, and I think anxiousness and everything else and all the feelings that we have either lie in the past or they lie in the future. You know, ki maine ye bola tha, ye ho gaya, makes me worried today. Or I want to do this, makes me anxious. You know, so, you know, my philosophy is one life to live, live in the present and, you know, stay happy.
Yes, happy thing.
Okay.
Thanks. Thanks a lot, Harpreet. And I think it was a wonderful session.
Guys, I'm on LinkedIn. My email ID is rajesgrover@gmail.com. Feel free to write any place I could help you. You know, feel free to drop a note. Would be happy to connect. Thanks.
Yes. Thanks, then. Bye.
For inviting me. Take care, man.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, folks. Yeah, see you next week.
Bye.
Yeah.